And she came in and she tried to get the methadone, and he said no. And I had to follow her around for like the whole time she was in the store, because she was probably gonna steal some, not realizing it even. Yeah, it was quite the experience watching someone as it happened. It's like, wow, that like nothing matters on that stuff, man. Like it was unreal, and I was only 17, and I saw that, and I understood it for what it was. But man, don't envy those people, and the ones that kick it like you, I have major respect for. It's
See,
rough. Same with alcohol.
you speak about that, and it's like you, as soon as you said methadone clinic, I never like actually was like a client at one. I used to ride with somebody that would go get his methadone, and they didn't force him to sit like drink it there. Like you could take your cup and like drink it while you're turning away or walking away. So what he would do is he'd bring his cup out, split it in half, and we'd get high. Or he'd get high and then take me to get dope because he was good, and I'd just give him like $40 in gas or whatever. And then, anyways, but
That's not a good practice, because the pharmacist would make, like, they'd have to drink it with him, and he wouldn't let them leave the store otherwise.
I know. I that's exactly how it should be, and that's their rule, but they never enforced it, and no one gave a shit. And it kind of like methadone. Like, look, I went through a med the medicated route, and like, I praise medicine. It's also kind of a curse because people use it as a crutch or they abuse it. And I don't like that. But it has done some great. Methadone, I've seen firsthand that a family member of mine was on methadone for years. I'm not supposed to be on it for long years, but she was on it 14 years, and they told her, "You're not supposed to be on this past X amount of years. Your heart is fucking terrible. Like, we gotta monitor it." Like, she had to like wean off a do like wean off like a lot of it because she had chronic back pain, so that's why she was taking it. She can't take regular opiates, but it's crazy. I seen methadone work that way. And then I seen just being a junkie, just methadone heads. It rots your teeth out, man.
Oh, I've seen them at all stages. My buddy actually had an employee who was still on, or was trying to kick heroin, and he was on methadone as well. So you could tell it. He'd go get it at lunchtime, and he'd just be way chipper after that. But prior to lunch, he'd be a grumpy son bitch.
Most of the people I met, they would be on such a high dose, like they'd just stay high every day forever. And it's crazy because they'd get high on that, and then as soon as it wore off, they'd get dope to tie them over for the next methadone shot. I just thought it was dark, and my darkest experience was being in a treatment center. Not for me, but so my buddy can get his dope, and then just looking over and just seeing a chick that looked like she was from that like Breaking Bad ATM episode early in season one. I don't know if you watched that, but anybody listening probably would
Like
know.
bad recently.
But
Well,
like
I know the one you're talking about,
yeah,
where
the
they steal
super
the
meth head
expensive
chick.
on his head. Yeah, it lands on his head and kills him.
Yeah,
Yeah.
so she looked
Them
like
exchange.
her, and her kid was crying, saying he was hungry. And she said, "Shut the fuck up! I gotta get this so we can make money." And I was like, "Dude, this is methadone clinic. This is sobriety." And I was like, "Oh shit, this is also addiction." I didn't know. Well, I didn't say this is addiction because addiction was just like a fairy tale. My dad was a junkie, and I'm not my dad. My dad's a piece of shit. That's what I thought at the time. My dad's my best friend, man. Like, because we were both junkies, so now I relate to him. But anyways, I was just thinking, like, dude, this is fucking dark. This is methadone. This is like being on drugs. That's what I thought. Like, not addiction, but this is being on drugs. And I was so shaken up that I went and got dope. And I was like, I would always wash. I presented myself nice. I went to work and all that stuff. I was kind of functional, but I would hang out with the unfunctionals. And just being in a nice like expensive clothes in the most rundown house while all these people that haven't showered in 4, 5, 6 days or eaten in 3 are getting high, and I'm like, this is the people I hang out with. And I kind of like broke away from that and then started just like picking, hanging out with like more suburbanites. But dude, that methadone, like the people that revolve around the methadone clinics, like it just got dark. Like I'd hang out with junkies and not feel as like depressed as I would on with people on methadone and heroin or just methadone. That shit's dark, man. I think it's like evil spirit juice, I swear.
Gets people.
Yeah. But anyways, I was meant to start this 4 minutes and 50 seconds ago, but people got a good story. This is episode 7-ish. Seven? Well, part seven, whatever we're going to number this as. I always change it up. Anyways, what has happened since, what happened last night, 2 nights ago?
So last time we left off, they had arrived back in Gadret's Hammer only to realize that Withers was still alive.
Fucked him.
And he had stowed away on the ship. So when they made their return,
and they realized that he had a relative with him too.
It was his brother. His brother was discovered to be the Chancellor of the King. So he is like the guy who makes sure his will is carried out. That's how they then figured out that that's how Withers got himself into position to hire the crew and do basically whatever he wanted. Also, they learned a bit more that I'll get into in a sec. There's an encounter on the docks where a Treetopper, a high-ranking member of the Sanctuary and the oldest living NPC from any of the player character parties, is still alive, and he meets them. After the encounter, they have an option to go with Withers and see what happens when they go to prison and see if they can talk their way out of this situation. Or they could choose to go with the Sanctuary under the pretense that they're going to go and deliver the message of war to their king. It all seems a little too easy, and it was supposed to. They get on the ship with Treetopper. They sail away. As they sail away, Quick lit a little fire on the other ship, and they fucked off, leaving a little smoke trail behind.
What did I want them to do? Did I want them to stay in jail, or did I think it was smart to go with Sanctuary? I forgot what I chose.
No, you had no choice in that one. That was their choice to make.
Well, I mean, like, my opinion, I meant, like, what was my opinion on? What did I think they should have done? I forget. Like, was it go to Sanctuary and use that? I forget.
I think that was your decision. Because going to prison, I mean, I wouldn't have killed them in prison, because obviously the story needs to go on. Just have them come back to kill them in prison's pretty gay. So I'd have had some sort of escape attempt. I had a backup plan where they were going to meet someone from their past, because I want to bring some of the stuff from that Dark Sun campaign into this. And one of those is, I know they're listening to this, so I don't want to give it away too much, but it would have been someone
from their past
to help them. Yeah, and they're definitely going to listen to that. So moving on from there, we started last session where they took off. I told them they only traveled one day because I had a fucked up view in my mind of how long this journey should actually take.
But how long did you think it was supposed to be?
I thought it was just going to be like a day and a half to get about halfway, but truly it would be about 4 days of hard sailing to get halfway.
Hard sailing, so that's like seven of just like pushing it, but not pushing it too hard.
I looked online. With good wind and oars, you can make about 300 miles on a really good day. And I have my whole world scaled out now. And before, I didn't really have that good of a scale. I didn't have like the, because the map now reflects being on a globe, where my map before was just flat. So it took everything and stretched it out more, so that I have to now wrap my head around just how large of a country these places really are.
That makes sense.
They get about halfway. During this time, I allow them to explore the ship, just like any good old Final Fantasy game, you know, where you get on those flying ships and shit, and you go and explore and meet people. They let them explore the ship. They learned a few things. Each individual's learning, I'll just start with Andromeda. So she learned that these are the people that can make her idea of a submersible come true. Remember that she was the person to invent the steam-powered engine, and they're going to use that to power the submersible. So this is all going to be part of the ongoing way that they get to interact with the war in a meaningful way. They're going to come up with a secret weapon, essentially. So anyway, she realizes that these are guys. I make a big deal about how they have brass tubing and how they've already got everything in place to make it. They just used to use magic to make the steam before. All the character has to do is wait a little bit, and then they'll make that Eureka, and then that'll be that. Moving on to Shaw. Shaw is an elf, and he wanted to spend time talking to Treetopper. I can't stress how important he would be to the people on the ship and everywhere else, and we're going to talk history on that in a few, so we'll get to that.
I know you mentioned, like, well, you kind of hinted last week that this was significant. This elf was.
Yeah, and he was, and this whole thing was about him. The thing I didn't like about this session, and I just wanted to kind of rush through it and get her done, is, again, I didn't really give them much. It was me telling them what was going to happen and what they're doing. Kind of very little role play, because I knew what was going to happen, and there was no sense in doing role play with what I knew was going to happen.
Yeah.
So Sean went through, talked to Treetopper, and then we did a bit of RP with that, because he's an elf too, and he wanted to know who he was related to. And he was related to Treetopper, but very distantly. When I come into his history, it'll be apparent why. So they're related, but like distantly related because of like how we would be related to someone 15 generations deep, like a long time ago. We're all related to someone according to Adam and Eve, but you know what I'm getting at.
Yeah, I know what you mean, yeah.
So Rob spent his time basically doing some RP and getting a history on him. This also endeared him to Treetopper, who's also an elf. So it was good. I liked it. It was a cool decision by him, I thought, in story-wise, and I appreciated it. Next up is Quick the Halfling. Quick the Halfling. Oh, what the hell did he do? I don't think he did anything really too significant. None of this is really his jam. He mostly just like did his own thing.
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah, like really, none of it was. I think maybe he talked to the Sanctuarians and kind of skulked about, but I don't remember him striking up any meaningful conversations with anyone,
When
not
you
the
say
captain.
skulked about, I just pictured Uncle Lester from Adam's Family.
Like so, that's his shtick, right? So then,
I
basically, I just do them in the order that they sit at the table.
got
So
you, yeah.
Sver goes last. He wants to start growing weed immediately because he lost his whole crop on the ship when they landed. But him being that type of guy, I'm sure he would have had some dirt samples with him. I think about Waterworld. You know how Kevin Costner had all those dirt samples with plants in them and shit.
Yeah.
Being like kind of like that. So it's like, yeah, I'll allow you to have a couple plants that you brought with you for sure. So he wanted to pot the plants. Then they get to learn that, again, while it's not hu super huge, super common knowledge, almost every member of the sanctuary is a mutant in some way. How that translates in game terms is they have a first to third level spell that they can use on command. I'll get into why mutants matter when I do the history thing in a minute. So from that point on, there's a percentage chance that almost any of them will have a magic spell that can help him. He got really lucky, and one of the people on board was able to create earth. So they made some earth, and he was able to start growing his plants immediately. He spends the 4 days tending to his plants, Treetopper telling stories of the history of the sanctuary, which I'm going to tell you pretty much the same story that he told. And then from there, they get to the end of those 4 days. On the beginning of the fifth day, Treetopper, who has unreal vision because he's so old, plus a few class abilities, because he's technically a 35th level character, topped out. Pun
Holy
intended.
fuck.
So he sees these ships way off in the horizon, pulls out his bow, and takes a shot from over a mile away. There's a cool feat where once you get to 30th level, you can get like epic stuff that happens to you. One of those things is as long as you can see it, you can shoot it, and you more than likely hit it at that level. So he just starts showing off, and plus, it's his big hurrah. He's going on, starts shooting away, but each warship has two heavy catapults, 160 marines, 80 sailors, a small command crew, and I know that they don't know a mage of pretty decent level. After
Ooh.
magic got sucked away and a lot of the mages in the world went mad or died, Galdrin made it their top priority to train mages right away to fill the void. So they quite literally
They're like the
also.
Nazi scientists after Germany.
Exactly. Like I can't stress enough how well
Hell
they just come to this decision to conquer the world. They put a lot of effort into it. They've got everything into place.
I'm down with that shit, dude.
And they're doing around. So
I
they're coming at
support
him.
them. I support them, the mages, because, sorcerer.
So yeah, they get up there. Treetopper sees them. They start shooting. They start learning about just how high tech the sanctuary is. So out of the forecastle and the stern, the rapid fire, or sorry, repeater ballistae pop out of the ground. So the basically, if you can picture a hatch opens up, and then you know how Luke Skywalker gets to sit in the Millennium Falcon on the quad cannons in the Star Wars 4.
Yeah.
It's feel like that. So they get to sit in these giant guns, the most futuristic things they've ever seen, made entirely out of mithril, and they have mithril tipped bolts that they shoot. These ballistae can shoot an extra 50% further than a normal ballista. Just souped up shit to again remind them that they just came from an island where they were eating fucking bark and goddamn meat for the last 7 months of their lives. So now they go from that to like the most high tech futuristic shit they've ever seen, and they just start having a blast. So Shaw jumps on a gun because he's an archer and he has excellent dex, and then the other gun Quick jumps on. So the two of them start firing away, having a blast. They have 20 round clips. They blow through all 20 rounds. They put some pretty decent holes in these warships, but again, these are giant fucking warships, 300 people a piece on them kind of deal. So they do damage, but they're not going to stop them. It soon dawns on them as the ships get close, they start using their stuff, but 80 guys on each ship have
Ooh.
heavy crossbow. So that's 320 crossbow bolts coming at you. I don't care what level you are. I'm not rolling 320 d20. You're getting fucking hit. You're going to get hit a lot if you stay on the deck. So they all retreat below quarters. This is when Treetopper realizes what actually happened. And the characters get to kind of learn this after what happens happens. So he realizes it's a hopeless situation. He starts talking to the air. Now, again, Treetopper came up with Lancelot, who's one of the bigger deals player-wise and god-wise. And he directly talks to him. You know, like a prophet would talk to God kind of deal. He actually has this god's ear. He tells him, "All right, I'm done. You can make me a god now. All I ask before you take me is that you save these four people, as I know you can't directly involve them, but I never ask you for nothing. This is my final wish, blah, blah, blah." So it's another Deus Ex Machina kind of thing where I took their choice and their destiny away from them to further the story in my mind.
Oh,
Because in
yeah.
my book, I have the ascension of one of the gods so people can see how it goes down. So from there, they get sucked up into Celestia. From Celestia, if you ever seen those old Hercules movies and the old the fucking Clash of the Titans, the old one where they have the gods and they look down on the chessboard and they can kind of see down on Earth, and
I kind of remember that.
you can kind of picture that too, like gods up in the sky looking through their own portable tablet version of the world to see what they want to see. So they get moved to Celestia. They see Treetopper all of a sudden strip back to his youth, go and embrace a giant half dragon. The both of them bid them farewell, and they walk off into the mists. There's only a heaven and a hell technically on Perenia. The heaven's called Celestia, the hell is called the Abyss. The Abyss has 13 levels, but they're all technically the Abyss still. Celestia has one level, but each god up here gets their own kind of 1 mile by 1 mile area of heaven that's theirs, but they have ultimate.
Why that small?
1 mile is a long way, but it all depends on the level of the god too. I believe that in the it's from a deities demigods is one of the books.
Okay.
And depending on the power of the god, they each get a certain size of their domain. Now keep in mind, you don't need a large area because it's kind of like the holodeck in Star Trek, where you can walk infinitely and it'll kind of fill in the gaps. You could run in that mile for 10 days and never reach the end, if that makes any sense.
Holy shit. So like
The
time, like
celestial
space
realm.
doesn't matter.
Yeah, time and space are different in celestial realm. Same in
Okay.
the abyss. Exact same. The 13 levels are just for the 13 demons of the abyss, which I honor because they're pretty cool demons and they harken back to the beginning of D&D. That fucking gay Stranger Things show with those punk little shithead kids. They have that demon in the first series, the first season. Not
I
Beelzebub.
never watched it, but yeah,
It
the
wicked.
audience might.
Someone's like, yeah, screaming it at the microphone. You know it. Anyway, that
You're right too.
demon is from exists in my world too. And all 13 of the demons are in the Book of Vile Darkness. So from this point on, they get to kind of watch what happens to the ships. They see the ship get surrounded by the heavy catapults. Heavy catapults can just shoot them at range at their leisure and then finish them off with crossbow bolts. They see the beginnings of that happening. They see the ship just get fucking clobbered with heavy crossbow, and it essentially starts to sink. And then that's where I cut the view off, kind of leaving them in wondering whether Nathan's, who is also on that boat, whether Nathan survived, whether any of the Sanctuarians they made friends with survived, because they met four Reclaimers. I'll get into what the Reclaimers are in a bit, but they meet four Reclaimers that kind of remind them of their old characters who are also Reclaimers. That was the goal I was going for, a little bit of nostalgia on their part. But they
That's
meet
pretty
those Reclaimers,
cool.
so they have the fate of all these people that they made friends with, and they don't know what happens to them, which leaves the door open for me to kill Nathan's or not, which I don't want to. I genuinely like that
No,
character, and
fuck
I
you, kill him.
feel it. No,
I'm
I
trying to
killed a bunch
smoke.
of other people. I actually like Nathan's, and I think I can still keep his plot line alive. He's the survivor, and he's the last living descendant of the first paladin of mankind.
Right.
So I think
Type
he's got a
one in the comments if we should kill
cool.
Nathan's. Type two if this is gay.
Yeah,
You always got to add the gay option.
Yeah. All right. People do it anyway.
That's true. That's true. Well, it always ends up being like 333 or like letters. Assholes.
So they, from there, they don't get to, they don't just get teleported back. Basically, Lancelot teleports them to the closest point on land from where their ship went down. And then they're on their own again. From this point on, because I took the decision away from them, I didn't feel like making them suffer through fucking checks and random encounters. I just wanted to hurry it along. They've done their time on survival. They did it a lot on the island. I didn't want to just keep it going.
They were going through it the last, like before we started the new campaign, they were going through it.
Yeah, they've done their time on those rules. They'll do it again, just not this time. So I accelerated them through the month. And over that month, when you walk for a month straight with the same people, you have a lot of time to talk. Yeah. In that time, I felt that they as characters, they're all highly intelligent people. They're like 14 plus intelligent, which is like Elon Musk level in D&D terms.
Holy shit.
Average Joe's like 8, 9. So anyway, over that month, they get a lot of time to analyze what the fuck happened. And in this time too, I kind of want to just tell them what happens so it's out there and I don't have to come up with it again later and forget it or whatever. So what they feel happened and what actually did happen was Topper handed them an opportunity to get rid of all the witnesses at once, right? Mm-hmm. Nathan's, who they also found out, is being impersonated this very second, going north with an invasion force to take over that castle. So the real Nathan's gets back. They can't have that. Also, all these people that know about the island are all together in one spot. They can take the peasants and just execute them, which is what they did, because they can get away with that easy. No one will ask any questions. But if they'd have let those people, like the group, go back to the castle, they'd have had to explain themselves. And the big takeaway for the group is, the king doesn't know about the pirate base. That's their big takeaway.
And wait, that really? Is a big...
Yes, he is not in on this scheme. It is strictly a Withers Brothers scheme.
Oh, well, then that makes it easier to bring justice.
Because if the king was in on it, they would have insisted on bringing them back to the castle to face trial, which they knew would have been fixed because the king passes judgment. There's no parliament in this shit.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
So they have a really good indicator of how deep this scheme goes. And yeah, that
doesn't seem that deep. Well, it depends on how powerful they are. Never mind, I take that back.
The most powerful nation in the world. And
yeah, I take it back.
It's a big scheme. If he found out his chancellor was betraying him, keeping something away from him, and it would be more of a, you're keeping profit from me than outrage that people died. Let's be real here. So that they're walking a dangerous game.
But if they use that, if they pander like, oh, you got people killed, that gets people to justify his like takeover. Taking over is still being, money grubbing.
Now there's another reason I wanted them to take a month to get back too. And that's so that all the stuff that is going to happen in the war can happen. And then they have to kind of come into it in the aftermath of the initial invasion. So they arrive at the southmost village that is Sanctuary owned that month later. And they discover that in that month that it took them to get there, every single Sanctuary in city is embargoed. The Sanctuary Navy, which was really only 6 ships, 6 beautiful, amazingly high-tech ships, but 6 ships nonetheless that were overrun by 5 to 10 times their number immediately. Those ships went down, took quite a few with them, but they still lost. So now the Sanctuary has no navy whatsoever. Boats all along its coast. The Northern Invasion Force took the castle without incident, and now they are ruling the north with impunity and establishing a beachhead in both places. That beachhead started, and basically, it's going to go to full force, because again, I gave them the choice of which country to help, and they can only help one. They chose Sanctuary, which means the Northlander campaign is going to happen. As I think you and I talked about it.
Oh, yeah, early on, where, like, one tribesman just takes over. Well, they war with everyone, then they take over, then they eventually try to go for the world.
They're going to give the tribes an offer to go fight for them, and the tribes that take that offer get to go across the water and start raiding the Sanctuary again.
But I also said I would like to see that that tribesman, like the captain of the tribe or whatever he would be, to get to the point where, like, as he interacts with other cultures, other people, still dominating them, he starts, like, getting smarter, more tactical, intelligent, learning how to play more politics, and then eventually stops taking shit by force and starts playing the, you know, the smart game. That's what I would like to see, where it develops into like heavy roleplay.
Well, I don't want to give away too much because they are listening to this now. But what I know, I will say is that he does factor in. He's not gone by any means, but he doesn't get to do that anymore because they didn't choose to help the Northlands. Because they didn't help the Northlands, he's not going to be able to unite the tribes. He's going to be a different factor in this war. So because they chose to help the Sanctuary, at this point, we've spent a good hour and a half going through the stuff that I just summarized for everybody. Obviously, there's a bit more roleplay, especially when I told the story about Treetopper. That took about 20 minutes. So from here, I asked them, what do you guys want to do for missions for the Sanctuary? So they decide to do a sabotage mission. They also meet the King, King Ash, who is actually Quick's old character, so he gets to interact with his own old character. I just play his character instead. I also asked him, as the King, though, how he wants to prosecute the war. Since he's there, I may as well ask him. It's his guy. It's not God status, so it's not like he's out of this realm anymore. So I said, do you want to go offensive or defensive? Knowing he wanted to go offensive, because let's face it, it's King Ash. And he wanted, but it was more, do you want to prosecute the war with an all-out, let's fuck him up, or do you want to be more guerrilla warfare? And he chose to go the sabotage route. Mm-hmm. So he is to help them on their next mission. I'm not going to let Quick control his old character.
All right, don't do that.
It'd be cool, and I might actually let him do it in something in the future. But yeah, I told him basically, you're going to have King Ash there. King Ash wants to do something directly so that the people can see that he is there for them. So he is going to go... Oh, that was his other choice. Whether he wanted to help the sanctuary cities or whether he's going to help the other states that look to him for protection. He knows the sanctuary is in his back pocket. They're going to stand with him regardless, and they understand the situation. He's
going
to go north solo to provide a distraction on the northern shores to keep them occupied while the sabotage happens. Sabotage is going to be done by the group on the sanctuary states. So he is kind of covering both bases, but personally he's covering the north.
Is that going to lead into the second campaign?
Yeah. And then so they are going to then be aerial inserted if they wish. I just said you'll get aerial insertion if you want, because the sanctuary has dragon. They only have 5 of them, and they're not like fully matured, but still 5 fucking dragons.
Yeah, that's dude, 5 fucking motherfuckers.
This is not like Game of Thrones. Those dragons will take another fucking 100 years and a bunch of gold acquisitions to grow a level.
Because how like dragons, a Skyrim dragon, like, are they like as beastly as Skyrim dragons? I feel like they're the most powerful fantasy dragons I've seen so far.
Well, the game is called Dungeons and Dragons, and the dragon is actually one of the deadliest creatures in the game because of the sheer volume of attacks it gets. The best staves, the best stat lines, the best to hit stat lines. They really are beasts. Like, they live up to being in the title of the game. So to have 5 of them is pretty good. There are 5 young adult ones, and how dragons level up is they have to acquire gold, and they have to sleep on that gold, and then they sleep on that gold for so many years, and they grow on top of that gold. Then they got to go get more, and then they put them in their lair, and they keep leveling up and growing. Pretty cool, actually. They have rules where you can be a player character dragon, and that's what you do. That's the motivation to be characters in it.
Yeah, okay. Like, well, yeah. When I asked about the, like, for the Dungeons & Dragons thing, I knew dragons were a part of it, obviously. It's just, for some reason in my head, I thought it was dragons because of the fantasy, like, stereotype, like the high fantasy stereotype, not dragons because, you know, dragons are like the shit in D&D.
Yep, they really are. They're very good monsters, and I use them as sparingly as I can. And it reminds me of a story that, so I played D&D when I was like in my teens. When I was about 17, I played with Lancelot's player, who I'll talk about in a bit. And Lancelot's player had another player character back when it was second edition D&D. And in second edition D&D, he had a dwarf. And this dwarf was pretty badass, but he was really, really cocky. And he knew he was going to go fight this dragon. And long story short, all I did was fly around him and hit him with the breath of weapon. And he was so mad because he had no ranged weapons that could hurt it. And if that dragon didn't come to the ground, he couldn't do fuck all but get roasted. So I roasted his ass for about 5 rounds before he was it's not coming down, is it? I'm like, fuck no, it's not coming down. Why would it come down
Yeah,
when
I
it
was
can
gonna
just
say,
go
why would
fly
it?
from up here? And that was a valuable lesson to that cocky bastard. So then he ran away. One of the few times that player ran away. He was a stubborn bastard. And he was like, shit. And he ran away. He had way more respect for dragons after that. And so did I, truthfully. So while I came up with the idea, I didn't realize just how fucking brutal it would be on him until he had like 5 or 6 hit points left. And he was like, I gotta tap out. And he was very frustrated with me. But at the same time, I could tell he respected what I did with the monster. So it was pretty cool. So anyway, they got 5 dragons. They're going to do an aerial insertion if they wish, or else they can take a boat, whatever. The sabotage mission they're going to do that they don't actually know what the details are yet. I just said sabotage. They're going to poison the food on the command vessel. This will be all the best Praetorian Guard type of troops. They're not called Praetorian Guard, but they'll be the best troops, the best mages, all the command crew, the admirals, blah blah, like the command ship. It's not an all
That'd be
eggs in one
a
basket.
good target ship.
It is, yeah, and it's not an all eggs in one basket thing. They want it to happen over time because they're going to poison the food supply. So they want these
Ooh,
guys
that's
to get
grimy.
sick over a matter of days, not all die at once. Because if they all die at once, they might retreat. But if people get sick a little bit after the other, and then what's going to make this? So that seems easy enough, right? Aerial insertion. I'll get into another thing they have that's going to help this a bit more. They have gadgets that are going to help them essentially get to their target. But from there, they got to make a choice. And this choice, they also don't know. Do they want to push their luck and go for more ships?
I see, that's a tough one. Okay,
Is
I'd
just
push the
go for
luck, to
10
be
ships or
honest.
try to get the other 10 ships? Because it's going to be 11 ships. 10 ships and a command ship. That's how the gelds work.
I'd go greedy, to be honest. Go for broke. You're already that far in.
And because they have no navy, they don't really feel the need to have. They like 11 ships is overkill, but Galdrin also knows that the Sanctuary has stuff like dragons and giants and half orcs and fireball spitting fucking flame newts. Like they know about because they have a long history of getting their rulers killed by Sanctuarians. So they know the Sanctuary quite well.
Hell
So yeah,
yeah.
they're very prepared. So that's why they have 11 ships. Each ship has 160 guys. So that's 1,200 plus soldiers right on their shores. Now this is not a war of annihilation. This is a war of conquest. They
Yeah.
kind of want to do it like the Romans did. They want something left over to rule. So they're
They want
not
their
just
own
going
people with their own
looting.
cultures integrated into
They're
society.
just sitting there. They know that the Sanctuary is quite a self-contained country. And they still have magic at their disposal, and they have an overwhelming amount of magic in the form of mutants. Problem with mutants is you can't depend on the power. It's born with you randomly. You don't get control over how powerful it is or even what it is. Some of them can be as pointless as changing the color of your hair. Like it's,
Really?
yeah, like mutant doesn't imply that they're all like the X-Men.
That's
Remember the
true.
X-Men
Mutant
that
just
are.
means they're a mutated human.
And Professor X went after the most dangerous ones. The ones that could change their hair and shit, he just left alone because they couldn't be bothered with. They wouldn't hurt anybody. But a motherfucker like Cyclops running around with red laser beams that cut people on calf coming out of his eyes, well, that's a kind of
Yeah.
guy that you want under your thumb where you can keep an eye on him. And the same principle applies in the Sanctuary. They weed out, kind of like the Jedi. They meet them when they're young, and if they show aptitude in certain things, unlike the Jedi, they don't take them if the parents don't want to give them up, and they don't believe in the no attachments thing, because the whole thing of the Sanctuary is they're a bunch of commies, right? They're despotic communists. Like they're communism without the bullshit of a politburo. They understand
Yeah,
that one government
okay.
has to rule them, so they're commies with a legitimate leader. Like maybe, what would that? Now there's a name for that. A good political term that I'm totally missing right now. But he's a despot. The leader's a despot. Everyone does what he does, but there's no currency. Everybody gives freely. Like that was the player, like Lancelot's wish, is
Prostitution's really broken then, Sanctuary.
unfortunately, as China found out, communism doesn't work. But communism can work when you have a front of cities that actually do get to make money, and everybody that doesn't need to use money just stays in your capital city. So they can bring in currency, and this therefore brings people into those cities, and they can have the best of both worlds, which is what they've been doing for the last 20 years or so. All their settlements are only about 20 years old. Now, the human contingents, they have to run on money. It's all they've ever known. And it's impossible to make everybody have the same standards as the Sanctuary does in regards to everything being free. So this embargo is the best thing they can do to whittle away at the resolve. Not only that, if they can conquer the Northlanders or the Northlanders in any timely fashion, then they'll be able to use the Northlanders to harry them, and they won't have to land a single troop. Then they can come in and say, you know, these Northlanders, they're a bunch of assholes. But
that's scummy as fuck.
But if we give the word, those Northlanders will stop. And since the Northlanders work for them, it's the oldest con in the book, but it'll work. Those people will do anything to stop being raided again. There are still people living that actually remember what it was like to be raided. As long as those people live, they will obviously advocate to just do whatever saves people's lives. So they've got this ace in the hole on the northern shores if they can conquer them in timely fashion, and if the player characters can stop them. If they can basically throw off the embargoes, then they'll be able to deal with the Northlanders as they see fit, or else go to the Northlands and try to take the fight to them. I'm not going to talk about what's happening in Fangorn, because it's very far away from them on the other side of the Lost Vales, and they have no real connection to it. And I don't want to give it away. I want them to have to find it out by actually going there. But you and I did kind of talk about what I was going to do with it privately. Hopefully you remember. We could talk after.
All you have to do is just mention like one or two details, and I'm back on it.
Yeah, and that was basically it. I just got to go get a glass of water. Be right back.
You are good. Oh, man. It's kind of a slow little session. I mean, we got set up for a lot of politics, a lot of backstabbery and fuckery. The party should get really greedy. That's what I think. I don't know if anybody else would agree, but I think the party should get greedy. Go for some ships or something. Be a pirate. Live out your fantasy and throw everything away. You know? You are a pirate. I don't know that song. Oh, man. Anyways, I guess I can just mark down the time and cut this. What?
Oh, I said thank you for waiting.
No problem. I was talking for a few seconds just to the listeners, and I was like, well, I should mark down the time so I can cut this fucking audio.
Thank you. I should have had some when I got here, but I was about halfway through, and I didn't realize I'd blow through it so fast.
You're good, man. Fuck. That's why I like recording and not streaming, because fucking breaks.
Yes. Oh, I'm ready when you are.
I continue to record, so we can hop right back in it. So you're going to start doing a history lesson.
Yes.
On what so specifically? So people know.
So this is going to be on the person I mentioned probably the most from the old characters, who is Lancelot. I know I've talked about him about five or six. Now, to the players listening, I'm probably going to tell you everything that I already told you Tuesday. So you can just tap out now. You don't want to hear it again. But I'm going to start from the very beginning of the very first character that I ever had on Perenia. His name was Lancelot. He was made by my friend from high school, the one I've already talked about, who had that dwarf. It was his very first character in 3.5, and probably the longest standing character that we ever got to work with. And we just decided to retire him because he got to level 17.
Why? Because the characters died, or because...
No, this one, because it was just getting too hard. Like, once you get to a certain point in D&D to do challenges, if you were too reckless with your items, like I was, and this is entirely on me too, I wasn't good about divvying out items. It was the rule of cool all the way, which I like, and it's fun, but is not conducive to high-level battles. I essentially gave him too much stuff at his disposal and made him so powerful that it was done. I was like, you've basically conquered my world. There's really nothing left. You've kind of wrapped the game, if that makes any sense. I made a final boss for him to fight. He did so. By this time, though, he had a full party of people with him. It was cool, too, because it was just me and him. So I'll go back to the beginning because I just skipped to the end. So at the beginning, it was him and I, just the two of us playing. He had moved to where I'd moved. It was nice to play D&D again. We hadn't played for probably 5 years. So I introduced him to 3.5, which I'd already played with someone else. So the first person I played with, which I could just briefly cover, his name was Matthias, character-wise. I honored his name as a paladin. He rolled really good stats for his first one. He wanted to be a paladin, which is actually, if you only have one player to play with as a DM, I could recommend making them a paladin. You have a lot at your disposal, and you're quite
Yeah, it's like
powerful.
magic, healing, and melee, right?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So you got all your bases covered, and you get spells eventually too. So they are good. So he picked that. We played about three sessions and then just tapped out. But it was still cool, and I tried to keep him around. That's why Matthias was the first paladin ever in my game. And then I made him the first paladin ever on my world. And he is the bloodline that Nathan's is descended from. Okay, so on to Lancelot. He made his character. Lancelot overall was a fighter, barbarian, rogue.
Oh
When
shit.
I'm gonna say the player's name because it's easier for me, and we don't even talk anymore. We probably haven't talked over a decade after his old lady ruined my last group. It's been a long time. I don't care if people know his name, and you'll never dox him. Anyway, so his name was Owen. Owen always made characters for power. He was the quintessential
Oh,
power
power
game.
gamer.
But I want to point out
Oh,
that his
sorry.
power gaining was also about the character, and that's what made it endearing. Also,
Okay.
I've never said that I wasn't a power gamer in D&D. Only I was a power gamer in the opposite way. I power gamed as a DM on the monsters. I would try to make monsters deadly as fuck, custom built most of the monsters from 15th level on for him just to give him a challenge. So I just met him. I don't want to police how people want to play their game. And that's what I see it as. I don't want to tell someone. And I've only ever banned one feat. And guess who used that feat to make me want to ban it? Owen. And I think banning any type is gay in a social situation. Banning is losing in my mind.
Yeah.
But this one, he took the quick strike feat and he turned the quick strike feat into this monstrosity on Grimm. Grimm is the god of water, and Grimm was another Owen character after Lancelot. Anyway, Owen's a power gamer, and Lancelot was built around this prospect.
Sounds like a
His
fun power
yeah,
gamer though, not an asshole power
he was
gamer.
a fun power gamer, and that's why I don't want to throw shade on him.
Yeah, that's
He was a cool
why I that's why I
in
kind
that
of wanted
sense.
to clarify if anybody was
Yeah, no,
confused.
absolutely. And he was my best friend growing up too. Like, I don't want to shit
Shout
on
out
him
to
that way. Just because
dude.
his old lady was like that doesn't mean I didn't hate him. It got awkward after that.
Yeah,
So everybody
understandable.
just kind of fell apart. Anyway, Lancelot's beginning. So the first sanctuary was actually, I was driving through Jasper with my old lady on our first vacation ever, and I was just looking at the hills and how basically Jasper is just one beautiful giant valley that you drive down that cuts between the Rocky Mountains. It's an amazing drive. If you've ever done it, it's pretty great, except for the fucking Chinaman tourists who flock all over the side of the road, feed the animals in front of the no feeding signs, jump in the middle of fucking traffic, take a
Asian
goddamn
tourists
tree.
are the worst. Every
Fuck.
city that has them, they're the
Oh,
worst.
so rude. Anyway, so going through there, thinking they're beautiful as hell, and I'm like, God damn, when I do D&D, I wanna kind of copy this. So that's when I made the Lost Vales. The Lost Vales are an interconnecting series of three valleys. When for the history of my world, there was a point in time where there were some mages that wanted to experiment. And these experimentations led to the very first metahumans on my world, which would be elves, dwarves, gnomes. The original race on my world was human, and all the other non-humans are derived of humans, even the orcs. All of this stuff, and that kind of explains how they were populated.
Yeah,
So these
okay.
scientists would explain, or they did this for a portion of time until it was found unnatural by the other gods. Or by the high wizards at that time. They were just really powerful wizards with no check on their magic. So they just did whatever the fuck they wanted. Now, these wizards are also the ones that rule the desert now, too, in sort. Rather than be the sorcerer kings that drain the valley of magic in the in their age. I kind of robbed that idea where I had the certain wizards that went to the north, decided to see how much magic they could pull out of the earth to see if they could gain immortality. And that's why they made the desert. They tried to become immortal. While other wizards retreated into a secret valley that they put a wall around that nobody could get through, an impenetrable barrier, where they could carry out their experiments in peace. They were not good people, but a bunch of them also weren't bad people.
It's not like terrible or sketchy.
Yeah, they're not horrible. So eventually these wizards are all killed and overthrown by their own creations. And the distinct races that emerged from this were the typical races. Now keep in mind, only in the valleys did these races get to flourish. They are nowhere else in Perrenia. So as far as population demographics go, Perrenia is 98% human still. Now, they did flourish in the valleys that they went to. So the elves took their own hidden valley. The dwarves took an underground section between the Gnomish Valley and the Elf Valley. And then there was another underground road that would connect to the human portion. Only the humans in this valley were not humans, they were mutants. And these mutants came about by the experimentations of these old rulers. The idea of mutants that I had came from the original X-Men movie.
It makes sense that you referenced
mentioned this before. But yeah, I liked the concept. I just thought it was a fun thing. You just give a character a spell-like ability. So guess what spell-like ability Owen chose for Lancelot? Because I said, yeah, you get to be a mutant for sure. I want you to be the first mutant, the coolest mutant. So he picked Cure Light Wounds. So Owen can now heal himself. So he has all the benefits without having to be a paladin. And not only that, the healing levels up with you. So he gets to do a D8 plus his level all the way up to 5, a D8 plus 5. And then he always has Cure Light Wounds at his disposal. And he gets it as many times a day as his level. Those were my old mutant rules. I've adjusted them since then. But like I said, I had to learn as I went. I made him too powerful. Sure. I fully admit this. So anyway, Cure Light Wounds was his mutant ability. He used a spear so that he could have reach. And then he also had longsword. Yeah, longsword for close combat. So he had all of his bases covered. He had 10-foot reach. He had meal covered. I know it's melee. Meal is my own joke. Only a few people know it. I'm not explaining it. Anyway, he had his meal weapon. He also had a ranged weapon in the form of that spear too, which he could throw. The very first thing he wanted to do was make that spear a spear of returning so he wouldn't have to get extra spears. And that was fine with me. It's cool. So, he had these three things. He had Cure Light Wounds, and he was a fighter, thief, barbarian. And he just cherry-picked, because that's your right as a human. As a human, you can just pick from whatever classes you want, as many different classes as you want, as that's the benefit of being a human. Other classes, like an elf, you're limited to how many cross classes you can take. You have your first one, and then they have one that's like built into being an elf that they can take at no penalty. But other than that, there's a penalty if you try to take more than a couple classes and you don't keep them all the same. I know it's rulesy, but it matters. But he cherry picks basically from all of his favorite classes, and we progress. His opening storyline is he is from the human side of, he's from the human valley, and his father is an inventor. His inventor father invented a flying machine. The people found the flying machine unnatural, and a few reasons that I'm sorry, this was over 15, 20 years ago. I'm trying to remember it all. But something happened that pissed off the people, and he had to escape. And the opening scene is Tree Topper walking through the forest as he usually does, jumping from here to there with his grace of being an elf. And he sees some flying machine hurtling through the air towards the earth. As it impacts, he sees the human that was flying the machine get thrown, and his neck is obviously snapped dead. So there goes Lancelot's father dead. Treetopper investigates further on, and he finds a human child inside of it, undamaged. He knows something is special about the child immediately. It's the only human he's ever seen in his life. As like I said, these valleys are all isolated, and the elves and the humans are about as isolated as it can get on those islands. They barely have any contact whatsoever. So he crash lands, he's raised by elves. So his whole backstory is he's raised by elves. Sorry, what was that?
I said, why is it that way?
They wanted the separation. Humans are not the most pleasant people to be around when they don't like you. And these weren't the best humans. Like I said, they were all experiments, and you learn off your master or the authoritarian figure usually. Good people have to be made. Usually it's easier to be evil, as Athas taught us. So that's why they want to stay separated. Plus, just the natural route around it, it was made so that people would be isolated from one another. So him making a flying machine to get over the mountain was revolutionary, and like I said, he'd never seen a human before. So here's Lancelot raised by elves. As he was raised by the elves, this is how he learned all of his different skills. And we start his first session as an 18-year-old young man who wants to go back to the human valleys to learn what happened to his father and why he had to run. I seem to recall something about there being a note in there or some sort of clue that let Owen know that he had to go back to the original valley to figure out what happened to his father. I will not go through all the stuff that happened for two reasons. One, I can't remember it all, and two, it didn't take too long because I didn't want him to. Once I realized how much fun we were having, it's like, I want to do more. I want there to be more for the world. I was also at this time reading. Let's go look at my books here. Is it Terry Brooks? No. Hell is he? It's his books off the top of my head. Anyway, there's an author who writes a book, a fantasy novel series. They're making a TV show on it right now where a guy named Randall Thor. Wheel of Time, that's it. So in Wheel of Time, Randall Thor goes to a desert and he becomes the dragon that comes over the mountain. In the time that Owen started that campaign and the time it took to get to the point he could leave was about 7 to 8 months of real time. And in that time, we both started working and making friends in the town. And by the time it got time for him to leave, I had a full four-man force ready to rock. And the valleys couldn't contain them. I didn't plan ahead at this point in time. Most of the time, we just bullshit, and I'd run them through some sessions of some stuff I'd thought of on the spot, and then we'd just go from there. But now all of a sudden, I had four people and all these different potentialities, so I wanted more of the world. Then I bought the map making software, and I built the rest of Perenia, the original one. I think I posted it in the Underdorks.
There's some stuff
The
I'm
original
going to put
Perenia is
together.
there. It's one of the very first posts, but it's ghetto as fuck. It's old as fuck. And I like it because it's built what I have now.
Yeah, it's
But
in
they
one of the
got
first episodes,
Crispin.
I remember.
Yeah, I think I put it up right after that. But yeah, he escapes the valleys eventually. By this time, he has a two co-workers of ours and one friend from outside the group. So that's our four-man group. Oh, an old buddy of mine that came up from where we used to live as well. We all moved quite far from where we grew up. He came after. I went by myself first, and he came up, and then we brought another buddy up. So four-man group gets through. I'm not gonna so much go through his adventures as more the how his character evolved. So as his
It
character
evolved into
evolved,
a
he started
great
as a human.
sanctuary.
Yeah, he started as a human, like I said. And then I wanted to start giving cool rewards as we got more people. And he wanted something to, like, he was a power game. He wanted to be more, to be better. So we agreed to give him a half dragon template. When you take a half dragon template, you grow a size, you get a breath weapon, you get some stat buffs. There's no downside to it. It's pretty great to be a half dragon. But it set him apart too. Some of the notable things that he did that I can remember that are kind of pivotal is Dragon Magazine had a, back when people bought magazines, Dragon Magazine had free adventures every month. Or not free adventures with the magazine that you bought every month for about $8. And one of those things was the Githyanki invasion. Githyanki are kind of like pirates on the astral plane. They drive ships that go through the planes between worlds. So they're kind of like spaceships, but the astral plane is kind of its own thing, which is really rulesy, and I'm not going to get into, but it's a different plane of existence where you can kind of fly, and breathing is kind of optional. It's kind of magical, obviously. And how that ties in is these Githyanki can go to any person's world through the astral plane and raid it. I thought, cool. Just like I'm doing right now, I kind of wanted to bring war to Perenia. So at this time, though, Britonia still existed, Lantan still existed, Seanchan existed, Sort existed, and Galdrin was the newest one on the block. The weakest country also being the
Shout out to
newest country.
Galdrum,
Yep. So this is where Galdrin's first appearance went. Not only that, the first place Owen went after he escaped the sanctuary was Galdrin. He went into Britonia, didn't really like the Britonians, and heard that mutants were being treated badly in Galdrin. So I guess I kind of skipped over that. So when he escapes the valleys, he brings the metahumans with him. So he brings the elves, the dwarves, the gnomes, all of these metahumans that want to leave the valleys, he brings with him. And when they go over, the first thing he wants to do is establish an underground base where they can stay at. He's going to call it Sanctuary. And no one's going to know where it is. His people are going to be safe there, and they don't have to live by the humans. Because if I remember right, he figured out why his dad pissed off the humans. He figured out it was the king. He killed the king, but he didn't want the kingdom. So he chose instead to lead an exodus of mutants and metahumans over the mountain as the dragon came over the mountain, because that's when he became a half dragon.
You
That
know
was
what?
his
Shout out
reward.
to him so far. I'm impressed. I like that.
One was a good player. He always gave me stuff to go with. And his enthusiasm is a lot like Andromeda's. Owen is an amalgamation of all four of my current players. We
And if
have
we go
the
back to
Hawkeye.
episode one, I talk about characters like that I really idolized in the stories and shit I watch. So shout out to, well, shout out to Owen and Andromeda, also because Andromeda's an OG.
Well, they all tie in, right? Like,
Yeah.
so we had the IRL relationship that me and Shaw have. Like, we hang out the most out of all four of us. Almost every day, our old ladies are friends, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Then he has the dedication that Andromeda has. Although Andromeda, I have to say, is more dedicated than Owen. But they're on the same par. He has the wit, the drive, the off-the-wall cool ideas that Quick has. And then he has the quiet, analytical spell selection and role play. Like, he can kind of put himself in his character's position instead of his own position that Zverik has. So I like that they all embody my best friend's growing up D&D abilities, and it helps me all in different ways. So yeah, so from there, he tried to fight off the Githyanki invasion using the sanctuary as a base. His first mission was to figure out what the fuck was going on, as the Bretonians were getting everyone was getting raided in the whole place because they had giant flying ships. So when you have a giant flying ship that's made out of almost impenetrable steel, because normal steel gets fucked up by the astral plane. So most of them are made out of adamantium. So it's the hardest, besides Obdurium, it's the hardest
Excuse me.
material that there is in D&D. So their entire ships are made out of them. And then they have these cool things called, and I didn't make any of this up. This came with the magazine. It came with stats for these
That's pretty
airships.
cool, though.
So it came with these things called astral thorns. Astral thorns are just the fucking coolest thing to me. So think of a kamikaze pilot. Only the ship doesn't blow up at the end because it's made of adamantium and it has an adamantium ram. It just rams straight through you and keeps on going. Unless you like fly directly into the ground, you're going straight through whatever you go, whether it be a boat, a castle wall, because it's harder than stone. It could be a house. It could be a stagecoach. It'll be a person. They'll just fucking fly through you and blow out a dragon. Anything. They'll just fly straight into you, like the name is, an astral thorn, and embed themselves in you and just keep going. So all of their air stuff is driven by captured air elementals. They take this captured air elemental and they put it in a special device whose name I can't remember because it's an obscure reference to, oh, it's right there on the tip of my tongue. But anyway, put it in this device, and this device is what powers the ship and keeps it afloat. First thing Owen wanted to do is capture one of those ships, obviously. He can fly because he has wings. So he goes up and solos a ship, kills everybody on board, takes the ship over, brings it down to his companions, puts them on board, and then from there, they start fighting back against the Githyanki. They go down to Galdrin to meet the king to see if they can set up an alliance. Also, Owen wants to go there to say, if you fuck with mutants anymore, I'll kill you personally. That was his message. I'm like, this is not the most diplomatic way to go about with the
No,
king
it is
of Rome.
not, but I mean, did it
But
work?
that was Owen, right? Owen balls to the walls, much like
Well,
Quick.
he I
So,
don't, from what it sounds like, he wouldn't make that call if it wasn't a smart play to make, though. You know, like
oh,
even
and it
if
was.
it's just being a dick, it sounds like he thought it through.
He did, only he didn't realize the king he was dealing with was actually a shape-changed Githyanki. The Githyanki
Oh.
had decided after they got to this world that they rather liked it here and they liked how isolated Galdrin was. So they wanted to take over Galdrin as their own personal base so that they could stop at this world in between raids and have a safe house, essentially. Only their safe house was a fucking kingdom.
Well, if
So the
only they
Githyanki.
probably communicated that, I'm pretty sure a diplomatic thing could have been made.
It could have, only Owen was high level and the companions with him were all high level, and they saw through the disguise and realized that the king and pretty much all of his advisors were shape-changed Githyanki. So with the cat out of the bag, there was a huge battle. Only the people that were fighting couldn't see through the magical disguise. So all the Galdranites thought that Lancelot killed their king. So then he inadvertently starts a war with Galdran. So he starts a war with Galdran, doesn't care because he has a flying ship. So he's like, fuck it, I'm out of here. So he says, peace out, bitches. I don't care if you want to kill me. You can't even find me because nobody knows where the sanctuary is.
Yeah, it's true. That's why it's called Sanctuary.
He's got tons of mutants. They can make stuff, tons of magic.
Self-sustaining magic.
Yeah, they also. Oh, I'm sorry. One thing I skipped over. One of the characters wanted to make Beric, and I had no real gods because I'd done away with gods at this point. There were no gods in my world. How I did clerics was you worshipped an ideal. You worshipped the ideal of good, the ideal of neutral, and the ideal of evil.
That's a pretty cool way of allowing an atheist to be a cleric, or like, you know, a cleric to abolish his like worship and then find a different way to practice, if that makes sense. A good weird spin on a character story.
Well, no, I'm happy you mentioned atheism, because atheism isn't a real thing in D&D. Because you can't be an atheist when the gods are real. You can't say you don't believe in God when they'll fucking show up. You watch their clerics get granted powers by saying their name. Atheists don't exist. Not to mention, if you don't believe in a god, you have nowhere to go when you die, which means you become a special demon. It's like the lowest demon class, and you get pushed around by everybody else. And it's a fate worse than death, because there is no dying at the end of it. You're this formless slug that gets pushed around by higher level demons from that point on. And the odds of you leveling up out of that level of demonhood are slim to nil. So you want to worship to someone. You want to be a fucking good worshiper, because you know, unlike real life with our world, that when you die, you are going to go to the place that you worshipped if you were actually devout. Now, because I say there's no atheist, that does not mean there's people that didn't pay lip service and barely believed. And those are the people, I think it's called a lemur. I think those are the people that can become lemurs. No, that's not right. It's not a lemur. Anyway. Yeah, so, yeah, atheism is not a thing in D&D, and it shouldn't be. If you want to be an atheist
now
in D&D,
that I learned, that's a good thing to know.
Yeah. It's cool. It's good that you mentioned it.
Now
folks,
I can find a way to break that, not break that, but have an equivalent.
Yeah, equivalency matters for this, because if people don't play D&D, they might not realize how to even deal with this, like, or not deal with, but equate this to what they do know. I noticed that you try to equate it a lot with video games, which is cool.
Because my background is MMOs, that got me into D&D.
And that's why I try to use video game references too, like Final Fantasy on the ships. I think anyone who's played the older Final Fantasies knows that you get like those cool vehicles that they always give you in those games to cover the world map faster.
Every Final Fantasy has a flying ship. It's just like some of it is like wooden, and some of it's like steampunk, I think.
Yeah, and that's actually what the Sanctuary one would have been like too.
Steampunk, that's right.
A lot of that steampunk shit on it. So they, he stops to get the Anki invasion, and when he does, he also discovers that the country of Seanchan, R.I.P. F.
F in chat.
The ones that got the Githyanki to come there. They're the ones that contacted them, and they're the ones that said, hey, there's ripe pickings here, and they were the slavers. For those that don't know, Seanchan was the slaving nation that was the connection between Sort, where the sorcerers would actually have slaves as a currency and a way of life, much like our last campaign. I kept that around. But the Seanchan were more like the Romans, where they used them and they still ruled themselves and they weren't immortals. So them having the Githyanki go and get more slaves was just peachy with them. The Githyanki wanted stuff, not people. So if all they had to do was go around and get people and stuff, and they had backers who would let them stay there, then they'll do that. So Owen discovers this, and Owen being Owen is fucking pissed off. So he goes there and he kills one important member and threatens the king. Just like I said, don't fuck with us or I'll kill you. This is your warning. And then they sent some assassins, and he killed them, and he let it slide. He was like, because by then, he basically killed most of the Githyanki, and they were on the retreat. And I used all the rules out of the Dragon magazine. And that, I never realized until now, just how much that one single magazine article changed how I do D&D forevermore. Because it was so well set up.
That's kind of good, though, right?
It is, yeah, because it gave me really how to do the framework to do a proper adventure. Because I'd just been winging it until then. Basically, I'd think about it during work during the week, or on my off time when I wasn't playing games, or the old lady, or whatever. And D&D would spring into my mind, and I'd think, oh, this will be cool to do. But I don't have overarching storylines like what me and you talk about now, where I've got pretty much the whole entirety of the campaign kind of road mapped and an idea for it. Like, I never had that before. So it really helped me. So he learns about them hiring him, gets pissed off, goes there, threatens them. So then, by this point, he advanced. He said, I wanted a family. So I hooked it up that he met a silver dragon female that by this point, she was a real dragon, but half dragons and real dragons can, they can mate, they can have a family, and she can shape change into a human.
That's
So
pretty
they can,
cool.
so they, like, they can have intercourse in a
So it's
normal
like
way.
Shrek's wife.
Yeah, it's definitely not furry nonsensical bullshit.
It's like Shrek's
So,
wife. Instead of ogre, it's dragon.
yeah, the donkey's like, but yeah.
Oh,
So, yeah, he wanted to have a family, and he met Silvara. So Silvara was her name. Silvara was also the name of the ship that the characters were on. And Silvara was almost killed by the Devil's Horns assassins. So now Owen's old lady has been directly attacked. Now, like I said before, Owen's pretty good, like Zverg, about really seeing from it. But there are certain things where Owen was blind. And sometimes Andromeda does this too, where they just cannot separate what they would do as a person from what their character would do. And they'll justify
It's
it in
kind
their
of good,
minds
but it's also kind of
however they
bad.
need to. And it's fine. That's the most human thing ever. And I'm guilty of it too. Very guilty of it. So he loses his shit. Not at me, obviously, but like his character is like, okay, enough is enough. Now he really went serious full mode. Him and the boys talked during the week. This is the era before texting or anything. So we'd hang out and stuff. And then they would talk for a bit, and then we go to each other's houses and smoke doobies and that kind of thing. So he came up with his
You
plan.
are
His
so
plan was,
boomer, doobies.
oh, I'm old as fuck. So he came up with a plan that first thing he wanted to do was get back at the Devil's Horns. Because now the Devil's Horns had been a thorn in their side for, well, now that by this point too, we'd been playing with these characters for about 2 years of real time.
Oh,
Like
shit.
a long fucking time, and our games really evolved, all that type of stuff. And Treetopper's been there the whole time. I mentioned before about how he's integral. Treetopper's been with him the entire time from level one. Right-hand man, always
Damn,
by his side.
dude.
He's his adopted father. He didn't want to do without him. And Treetopper was my NPC. So technically, Treetopper's me. I played him as my own character. I don't do that anymore because I got four guys and I just don't have the time. And really, I want to make it about them. Back then, I wanted to play a lot more than I do now. I didn't get as much satisfaction out of just DMing. So I wanted to play him. So I made Treetopper, and I would always think about ways to power game him because I was
Yeah.
about that too, to keep up with Owen. So I made Treetopper into a fucking machine gun. Gave him an elven double bow, gave him rapid fire, gave him multi-shot, gave him the Deepwood Sniper. Deepwood Sniper's fucking insane. If you just see someone, like even like just 10% of them, you get to shoot them as if there was no cover at the top of the class. It's just insane. It's so good.
You know, I just thought of something. You made a comment that you banned a feat because of Owen. Why did
That's
you
right.
ban that feat because of Owen? I don't think you ever got to
So
that
the
point.
details of it are Quick Strike, and there's a thing called Attack of Opportunity. Now, I took the ban off after talking to Andromeda and reading the rules with a 20-year older set of eyes that understand things a little better now.
Yeah, for
And there was
sure.
one blatant thing in front of my face that I could have said, but I didn't notice it. Owen may have noticed it, but he wouldn't have told me if he did, let's be real. So, what it does is, okay, me and you are in melee combat right now, duking it out, fist
Yeah.
to fist. I'm losing. I want to bail out of there. If I just turn on you and run, you get what's called an attack of opportunity on me. And you get a
Yeah, 'cause
free
your
hit
back's to
if
me,
I
you
turn
can't
my
defend
back and
it.
run. Yeah, so there's a price to pay for turning and running, as in real life, right? That's how a
Yeah.
lot of people died in wars. They turn around, a lot of swords in the back. So with this in mind, attack of opportunity, you normally get one per round on one person. Or sorry, one per round. I didn't know on one person that. So one per round. You can get a feat called combat reflexes, which gives you an additional amount of attacks of opportunity equal to your dex bonus. Owen would always build with
That's
dex in
pretty
mind.
good.
Yeah, which would mean that he would have about plus three or plus four. So now he gets four or five attacks of opportunity per round. What you do is you tumble, which is a skill, You tumble into the midst of some enemies.
Tumble is like a front
Fighting
flip
them.
or a roll, right?
Yeah, exactly. You tut, you
Okay, I just
flip,
wanted to make
dive,
sure myself.
dodge, all over. Yeah, no, and that's a good, fair question, right? It's a skill in D&D that you can get if you're a rogue.
That's pretty
Remember I said
cool.
about cherry picking? Owen would always for tumble. Tumble is insanely powerful because you are immune to attacks of opportunity while you tumble.
It's kind of like the dot,
You
it's
can
kind of
go
like the
wherever you
roll in
want.
Dark Souls.
Jackie Chan is how I think of it, but Dark Souls is also very accurate. So basically, Owen would use this tactic. He would get into the midst of them all and start fighting them. If they tried to move for whatever reason, attack of opportunity. For various reasons, you have to move in that game. So in sometimes he would get three or four attacks of opportunity. But this
Damn,
wasn't enough
dude.
for Owen. Not enough for Owen. Owen wanted more. Owen wanted them to do it when he wanted them to do it. He didn't want to wait. He wanted everybody to die in his vicinity. So what he did was he found the ultimate combo. I'm going to say a bunch of rulesy shit. Probably not going to make any sense. Anybody who knows knows, and if you don't, you don't. The
Oh,
end
we'll
result
learn.
is the same. Owen was able to make it so that bad guys would trigger attacks of opportunity. Then when they triggered attacks of opportunity, he would get another hit. So I'm going to say that again a little slower in a way that will make a bit more sense to those who don't know the rules that well. So what he would do is he would make a bluff check. He would always stat out his bluff and do whatever he could to maximize his bluff. If this bluff check succeeded, which often it did. Now, I also want to point out that there's obviously monsters this won't work on, but a vast majority of stuff that he fought, it does work on. Anyway, and this character, this one, was grim. So he would make them do a bluff check. They fail the bluff check. This gives him an attack of opportunity. He hits them. An attack of opportunity, you're not allowed to use anything special on. You can't trip. You can't disarm. You just hit at base weapon damage or whatever the weapon damage is, plus your strength like normal, and Bob's your uncle. And it should stop there. Only Owen didn't stop it there. Because when you get quick strike, you get another attack on top of that, which means this attack can be anything. So you could disarm, you can
Damn,
trip,
dude, that is OP.
right? So he gets two attacks, not on his fucking turn, I also have to point out.
Oh, well,
Because attack of opportunity
that's
happens on your
worse.
enemy's turn, right?
That's
So,
arguably worse because there's no restriction technically at that point.
okay, but there is, but I didn't get it. So now I'm going to fast forward through a few
Oh.
battles. And what broke me against it, not broke, but pushed me against it, was there was one session. Owen tumbled in the middle of five enemies, five pretty decent enemies. And this is Grim, who had five dex. So he got six of active opportunity. Now it could be one or off on the amount, but either way, he got a shitload of attacks and killed all of those guys in one turn. Oh, did I mention that Brim had a touch attack that paralyzed someone? So guess what he did? He would make them do a bluff check, hit them with an attack of opportunity, which happened to be his paralyzation attack, and then he would use the quick strike to coup de grace them and kill them outright.
Nice, so cheap.
He did that to all six. Nobody else even got to act in the round. All the guys looked at him. They just didn't even look at me. And they said, "Owen, why the fuck are we here if you're just going to kill everybody by yourself?" And to his credit, Owen's face actually went red because he's one of those people where he's not there for the group, he was there for himself. And that was his only character flaw that I didn't really like, and I have to say, he didn't really care about other people's good times. He
That
was
kind of
there
sucks
for
because
him.
it's a group game. It's not
Yeah.
a single player
And you
game.
want to know his most, the thing he said to me the most that will never leave my mind? Is it my turn yet?
Oh
Is it my
my
turn yet?
God.
Is it my turn yet? How about
That's
now?
the
Is
worst.
it done yet? Is it my turn yet? Yeah. And it's just aggravating because it would bother me because he's demanding my time when I'm trying to see to four people. And it's insulting to the other people in the group because it implies that their actions aren't as important as his. And that's what bothered me the most.
Yeah,
So
I
when they
feel
all
I'm
turned on
with
me in
you.
that game, that was it for Grimm. And then he kind of dialed it back. He knew. But we all knew. He didn't change anything about Grimm. I didn't step in and say, "You have to stop doing this." I just said, "No more quick strike." Now, there was more to it
It
too,
sounds like he was
which
still super OP without it.
it is. And he could coup de grace like that. But what I didn't realize is, what he could also do is say they make the paralyzation save and they're not paralyzed, he would hit them And then he would just do it to the same guy again, because he'd have multiple attacks in a round. So he'd bluff him, draw it on his round, right? This is if he does it on his turn. Sorry, I fucked up there. If they go and just do it on their round and he gets an attack of opportunity, it's on their turn. But when he uses the bluff check, it's on his turn. But he gets to double dip into it also. So he triggers it, and then if the paralyzation goes through, he would just try to do the bluff check on that same guy again. They'd fail again, and he basically whittled one guy down solo. What I didn't realize, and what anybody who plays D&D 3.5 or I think Pathfinder 2 should know, is you only ever get one attack of opportunity on one guy in one round, fucking period. If you have six attack of opportunities, all six of them need to be against a different guy. Yes, all six can
Yeah,
be.
I agree.
Yes, you can use quick strike on all six, but you may not attack of opportunity the same guy if you have combat reflexes. And I fucked up on that, and that was my fault. But honestly, it only came up on a few large monsters that more than likely would have killed most of the party anyway. Because the other disadvantage to that was now it's not me making monsters that the party has to kill. I was strictly making monsters that would keep Owen occupied long enough for anyone else to have a turn.
That's sad.
It is. And again, that's on me. I should have saw it. He even told me what he was
Well,
going to
this is
do,
good for new
but I just
players. This is
I
good for
couldn't
new
fathom.
DMs.
Yeah, he was a fucking virtuoso at 3.5. He's like Andromeda. They will go on a tangent and they will find every fucking rule related to that tangent and they will build around it. Andromeda's good example of this is his monk. He puts and he's not a netlister, and yes, he's a self-avowed power gainer. But man, that monk, Jin Crow, was untouchable. Man, he said from the beginning, "I am making a monk you are not going to hit, and I hope you fucking get used to it." And he wasn't wrong. I maybe hit Jin Crow a handful of times. His AC was upwards of 30, 31. Normal people are 20, 21 at like level 7 or 8. And by the time he topped out, he was pushing 40. I couldn't
Jesus.
hit him. The only time I was hitting him in a normal attack with a normal monster that wasn't keyed against him with some sort of magic was I had to roll 20s myself. That was the only way I'd touch him. Now, to his credit, he paid a price for doing that. He was a glass cannon. He had like 40 hit points because he dabbled in so many different classes to get to this perfect storm of AC buffs that he wasn't able to capitalize on having decent hit points. He had to have three really good stats, and those stats weren't constitution. So he was a literal glass cannon. So when I hit him, it would be a critical. And if I sometimes have to confirm, I would sometimes roll two 20s in a row,
Oh,
and he would be almost
shit.
dead in a couple hits. So he learned, like, and honestly, Jin Crow is one of my favorite ones. He's the
You
god of
kind of
knowledge.
play,
He has
you can't
a cool backstory.
be like, you got to play kind of humbly too. Like, build
Yep.
humbly, I should say.
Yeah, Andromeda doesn't act like Owen in regards to me, that's for sure. He's much more team-based. But yeah, just so yeah, that's Lancelot. And then when we got to the end of his tenure for the Sanctuary, I was like, okay, so Sanctuary is not yours anymore. This is what I tell all people that give up their characters. I won't have you bouncing between them, especially when you have a super powerful character and there's a bunch, and we had two new guys by that time. And we were starting over again because these guys were coming in and Owen was already level 17 and they had never played before. And I wasn't going to bring level ones into a level 17
Oh
campaign.
yeah,
That's
that'd be bullshit,
stupid.
bro.
And at the same token, I don't want to start them at level 15 or 16 because it takes away the appeal of leveling up. So I was like, we got to retire these guys. It's like, yeah, I agree. I want to have fun with these new people. You'd be good on that stuff. So we talked about it and he said, this is what it's going to be. Sanctuary is going to be a thing. I want it to continue to be its own thing. We're going to live in secret forever. There's xenophobia across the board. We will send people out whenever they want. We're not going to keep people here like it's prison or
Oh,
anything.
yeah.
But yeah, that was what he was about. So that's where he set up the Kami Utopia. Kami Utopia. And over time, the warped, and I moved away, and we parted ways, and I started with the group that I currently have. And we revisited Perenia 100 years after the sanctuary's been in there. Owen had a son. His name was David. David was a character. The very last character that we played was David. David was He was born a half dragon because he was Lancelot's son, obviously. And David, I'm trying to remember what he was. We only played him a few times. Truthfully, he didn't get past level 5. So I
Really?
don't have the memory of him. Plus, we were getting really good weed at that point in my life, too. I was about 27, 28. We were all journeymen by this time, making fucking good coin. None of us had kids yet. So, like, there would be huge bats that we'd just pass around and play all night. So there's giant fucking portions missing in my memory from that time. And then one thing I super
When you
regret is
remember,
after,
I know when
and
you
he took
remember
the time,
more, you'll visit.
Owen took the time to draw the sanctuary to scale that he wanted to leave behind. And me being an idiot, I was pretty upset at the end of that whole ordeal where his old lady fucked everything up and I threw it all away spitefully, like a bitch. Shouldn't have. I should have been a man and kept it regardless, which is my new policy. I actually don't see eye to eye with one of my old characters, and I'll never have him back in my group. And I'm still not going to get rid of his stuff. In fact, he's still quite an integral part of my world. But him, the
Yeah,
player,
it's
no, I've written him off. But I won't kill my world for my own fucking
yeah
annoyances
for
anymore.
your own like emotions. Yeah, that's all good. That's understandable. I actually respect that. It's like because you can differentiate like the memories in the game versus just the bad fallout.
Just that corona nonsense fucked everybody up. And it just
Oh
made,
shit.
it makes you see people differently too. Like you see who the true authoritarian type peoples really are. And then it never really occurs to you until this type of thing
Were
happened.
they like
And then
super
you think
strict
back
on
about
Corona?
stuff they said. Like this person told me before the whole corona thing went down that he thinks people shouldn't be allowed to eat and drink in their own cars, that the only thing they're in there to do is drive.
What a
That they
fucking
should be
idiot.
arrested if someone sees them eating or drinking behind the wheel because it's too much for anybody to deal with.
All right, I
And the
definitely can see where
cops
you're
do all
going.
sorts of shit, but he could justify cops. But it shows his authoritarian leaning, right?
Yeah.
So that, and it was right there in front of me, but I never picked up on it. And then I hear about him fucking policing people on Facebook and telling them they should get
Oh.
the shot and stuff and basically making other people's business, not his own. And I can honestly say, and I'm so proud to say that every single person in my gaming group didn't do that type of thing. None of them
If
did.
they had those had some feelings like that, the smart or respectful person would just, yeah, if even if you disagree, your opinion, you being an asshole is not going to change the non-maskers or vaccine people's minds, so why does it matter? Just protect yourself as best you can, if that's your thing. You know what I mean? Like, people should have
Yeah.
just kept to themselves.
It's authoritarianism. There are people that think that other people exist to tell them what to do, when it should be we work as social, not so much, like we all work together to create laws that are as fair as we can do in our fucked up world. And we put different checks and balances on this government to make sure one section doesn't get out of control. Like America has that, right? Like they have Congress, the Senate, judiciary, right? Those are the three branches they have.
I
And
think,
Canada
yeah.
has two, right? Like we have our judiciary and our parliamentary. I don't even care enough about Canadian politics to really
Don't
bark
care
about
enough
it.
about politics either,
I'm
bro.
fucking leaving this fucking shithole country anyway. I don't care. But like government itself does have checks and balances on power, and that's all built into the structure. We're supposed to honor all those things. And there's always the people that they want a king. They don't want people to have the choice. They want one guy to exist that says, this is how it's going to be. And for a long time, that got us by. But we're past that. Now we're just ruled by the super rich in a different way. But man, I'd love to live in a world where they didn't rule.
Yeah, that'd be interesting to see how that worked out. Well,
Well,
how
they've
that would
ruled.
work out.
They've ruled in my world, so I can't even fucking tell. But yeah.
So, any more history for Sanctuary that you want to share or that you
No,
can remember?
I'm sure there's stuff that missed, but I just wanted to impress upon the people like how old the history is and how player driven it is. Oh, I never finished the one story. So the Devil's Horns, they tried to assassinate his wife. His retaliation was killing every single one of them. So he exterminated that guild. By this time he had Max 3000, who was a Githyanki Yankee that turned sides, kind of like he wanted to make a Githyanki after fighting them. He's like, fuck, these are cool guys. Can I make a character to be one? I'm like, yeah, no problem. Because again, we were kind of at that point, we had four people but it was always the more the merrier. We had
Yeah.
huge squads. I had like five or six NPCs too, but I was starting to phase out my NPCs in favor of player characters. They wanted to make max. Also, just to take a break from Lancelot to help level up the other guys too. He was cool about that.
That
They
sounds
kill every single
nice.
Devil's Horns, and then they bring all the bodies back to the sanctuary, and they cut all the heads off. And then they assassinate every town leader in every town in Seanchan, like the big ones, not like little villages, but all the ones that matter. They assassinate the high-ranking leaders and leave a devil's head horn in place of their head. I don't know, Owen was weird like that. But yeah, he wanted to do like this crazy message to them all. And then he personally killed the king of Seanchan, and then they systematically raised the
That's the
entire
slave
country.
area, right? The slave people, right?
Yeah, and he
Seanchan.
killed the He razed, like Carthage style, he razed every single major city of theirs to the ground
Holy
and
fuck,
told the
bro.
people, come back here, I'll kill you. So he caused this great mass migration of people away. Where's the
Purge.
closest place they could go? Seanchan, or Sort or Britonia. So they either had to go to their enemies of 1,000 years, Britonia, or the people that used to supply them slaves. And over half of them were taken slaves.
Oh,
It's a good
that's
old just dessert,
fucking,
right?
yeah, it's like petty just desserts. I love
And
it.
then that's the end of the history lesson. That's the last thing he did that mattered. He destroyed an entire country. So that's what I told him. I'm like, it's time to retire. You destroyed an entire fucking country. And we took our time about it. I tried to be really realistic about it. But like I said, he was so goddamn powerful that there wasn't a lot of legitimate things I thought that I could do to them that made sense. Because I don't like just in venting. Like all of a sudden their king was actually the super powerful half demon that
Oh
could
yeah,
fight
the
Owen on Earth.
BBEG
Like,
in hiding.
no, he was just some fat faggot that got rich off of fucking slavery. He didn't fight. When they got warriors, they just hire mercenaries. Although they were so far separated from anyone that offered them any possible resistance, wars weren't really that common for them. They fought Britonia, and that was it. Nobody could fight Sort because it's a fucking desert. If you're not built for the desert, you can't fight there, plain and simple. I mean, the Romans did it, but they only penetrated so far. And you're going way further into the desert of Sort than you would ever go into the desert of Earth. So, yeah.
Oh damn. I think well, shit. I really like that history lesson. Could we do Galdrin next
Own
week?
ramblings and memories, but still, I hope somebody enjoyed it. Glad you
I
did.
fucking do. Like, 'cause it gets me more excited to be a part of, the next 20 years of lore,
I love making new lore. Like they were there to see, so that's why Treetopper is important. He was there the whole way. He was integral in every single thing I mentioned. He was always there. Lancelot's right-hand man. He was the last one of that original crew that was still alive. So imagine being 450 years old and all your friends or gods are dead.
Oh, that's so
So he
sad to
was
have all
lonely.
your friends
And if he could
dead.
do something, I just wanted to pay homage to that character. And I can put that in the book that I
I
write so
respect
people
it.
that read it can see how someone ascends. And
I'm
then if
kind
I
of a
ever decide to
similar
write
way.
if I write prequels, then they get to see the young Topper. And then I could do more stories. I do remember quite a few of them, but I mean, you do so many battles. And I didn't keep any of the original Valley stuff. Like that stuff I didn't lose on purpose, it got destroyed. I bought, like, when I got back from that Jasper vacation, I went to the art store. I bought colored pencils because I didn't own the map making software yet. And I actually hand drew all the valleys to the best
Oh,
scale
it's
that I could.
tedious.
It was, but it was rewarding because as I drew it, I was like, fuck, this is cool. I kind of want to put a bad guy here. And I put a little fucking skull there or something. And then went through and I drew the Elf Valley, then I drew the Dwarf Valley, that was also the Gnome Valley, and then I drew the three-part human valley. And yeah, that was kind of the beginning. And then I took those out of the art book, transferred them to the computer as the very first thing I did with my map making software. Those things, they got destroyed in, I want to say, water.
Oh damn,
Yeah, water somehow destroyed them. It might have been a spilled drink or something.
dude. Sabotage by an ex player.
Nah.
Well,
Those would be cool. I wish I still had them.
1 hour and a half, man, on 1 week.
Yeah, rambling takes time.
Yeah, but
Oh yeah.
it's also
It's almost like radio
interesting.
people do it.
Hey, if I learn anything on YouTube, it's how to literally say, I like this game, and make it a 40-minute video. So I'm good at that.
Yeah, true enough. Those game reviewer people, they can... We're cog. Let's make a fucking 2-minute video, 30 minutes.
Ha ha! Yeah, to get some shots. Well, let's see. Hour, 10 more seconds and we'll stop it at exactly 1 hour and a half. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Cars roll.